Let's now talk about initializers for arrays. Remember, we can cast a structure or an array to the right type using a cast notation. So if I want to cast something to be an array with, of two integers, I can use this notation, in brackets, integer, 2. So what I can do, I can now create an object which has no name and fill it with two values, two integers in this case. So in the stack, this will look like that in my main stack frame, I will have basically somewhere stored these two values, so element 0 and element 1 with value 1 and 2. And now if worker 5 needs an array of two elements, we can take this temporary object basically as an argument, and then this array will point to this unnamed object inside main. What we haven't talked about is the usage of strings. Remember, what is a string? A string is actually a pointer to characters, so it's an arbitrary long set of characters terminated by null. And if I give the compiler a fixed string like test string here, this must exist somewhere in main memory, typically exists in something called the text segment, which is a different region in memory than our stack that we know about so far. And then when I use test string somewhere as an argument, what will happen is that the string basically will point to this memory location. And it's typically a constant. And the behavior of these kind of things that I just explained to you, they are system specific and may be also compiler specific. So let's talk now about pure and impure functions. When you use a pointer and we have global variables, a function can basically do anything. We have therefore a definition. We say a pure function. In a pure function, the return value is only determined by the input arguments and not by any global variable, any side effects, and so on. That means when you call f on x, you will get the same result in terms of system result as calling f on x, and you call f on x many, many times. Every time you get the same outcome, you don't change any state. Note that it means that for a pure function, all the functions that it calls itself must be pure as well. Otherwise, you know, this statement wouldn't be true. So they should not have a side effect. Let's talk about side effects. What is a side effect? Well, it means you output something to console, to the terminal, you do some kind of operating system call, you update global variables, or you write data to a pointer variable somewhere in the main memory of another function. And now that we know about pure functions, well, impure functions are basically those that violate one of these rules written here. So here we see now an example function, print text received, and we have here a global variable total. And what happens in this function is that it has two arguments, the values and the number of values given. And well, what it does, it basically accumulates the total with the inputs given as values. That's what happens here. And it calculates a total tax. Okay, so it sums up basically the inputs and outputs the total tax up to this point. Okay, have a look at the code, try to understand it a little bit, and then continue with the next slide. Because now what you should do is you should really try to investigate this function in more detail, and you should make the decision if it's pure or impure. And if it is impure, figure out why it is and have some arguments. Again, here are the rules by which we define what is a pure function, and an impure function violates those rules. Okay, so have a look at the code, and once you've done that, we will talk about it. So first of all, what we realize is, well, this kind of function here, it uses total, which is a global variable. So in that sense, it already violates our idea of an impure pure function, so it is impure. Also, printf is impure as it has side effects by printing stuff on the terminal. And lastly, what you have to decide is, well, it depends on how we write the sum function. So we see it uses here this function called sum. So it depends on how this function is written. On the left-hand side, we see an implementation of sum where we only basically add the two arguments together. So this is a pure function. It has no side effects, only depends on the input. You will always get the same output when you put in the same input, right? I think that's easy to see. While on the right-hand side, what we see is a function which uses this global variable total, and it prints, even worse, it prints to the terminal. So that one would be impure. So in that sense, it's logical that a pure function can only call other pure functions. Otherwise, if it calls one impure function, it becomes impure. A good thing about, and why we actually learn about this definition, is that pure functions are more reusable because it's clear what they do and you can use them concurrently. That means many, and if you have a parallel program, many threads operating in your code, it will not change the result by calling this function many times. It also doesn't mean that impure functions are bad. Printf, for example, is impure as it prints to the terminal, but it's a very versatile and useful function. So our goal as a programmer should be to have some kind of predictable code. So our functions should have one job, and they should avoid side effects if they are not necessary, so they should be pure if possible. So if you think about the function that we had before, this really huge print text receipt function, it actually has two goals. On one hand, it accumulates the current total of money, right, by the values, and then it computes the tax on top of it. Okay, so it has two tasks, and lastly, it even prints, you know, the tax. So we could say it has three tasks. So we could write a pure function getTax, and then we could have an impure function called printTax, where we input, you know, the tax, for instance, or the current amount of money, and then it computes the tax. Different ways are possible.